From Carolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guests today, Frank Stallone and Jason Whitlock. With Gina Grad on news, Bald Brian on sound effects, and Kyle Dunnigan drops by. And now, before last week, he definitely would have spelled sedition with an S-H-U-N. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. I don't get that joke. Got to get it on. No choice but to get on. You mandate you get it on now. Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Handball, Brian.
Okay. Are you kidding me?
The great Santino Carolla.
Oh, it bears a strong resemblance to a young Frank and Sly Stallone.
The
documentary of which I watched yesterday. Lots of footage of them as youths, and I'm like, that is Sonny Carolla. I am looking at a young Sonny Carolla.
Yeah, I guess that's right. Well, we have
spitting.
Pull up the pic.
I woke up this morning to a nice text I got from an old friend that said celebrating 10 years of sobriety. Thanks for paying for rehab, which
That's
I completely
nice.
forgot.
Did
about.
Did you just reply saying quitter?
Hallmark doesn't have a card for that?
I do forget sometimes if I pay for stuff for people. I just forget everything, I guess. I try to dwell on the negative. So I was like, I paid for your rehab 10 years ago.
Wait a second. Is this someone who came to you to ask about that? Is this something you offered? Do you remember the circumstances of paying? Rehab can be very expensive.
Dear friend, old friend, had always struggled with drugs. And I think about 10 years ago, finally decided to make a real move. And probably came to me to ask if I could fund it for him, and which I evidently did. So
that was evidently nice of you.
Yeah, it's funny because when I talked to my nanny Olga some years ago, and she was like looking at a new car, and she's like, "I'm thinking about selling my old car," and I said, "How much did you pay for your old car?" And she said, "I don't know. You bought it for me." I thought, Jesus Christ. I got to write some of this shit down.
You know, in Judaism, there's a hierarchy of tzedakah, which is not kneel, but
I
like charity.
Mm-hmm.
And one that gets you toward the top of the leaderboard is, you know, doing for others, giving tzedakah and not asking for anything in return. That's your jam. You don't even remember you did it.
Yeah, you know, I think it falls in line with my lowish self-esteem. Also, people I don't like who've taken a bunch of stuff from me, I remember because I'm like, I did this and did that and did the other for this person, and this is how they repay me. Right. The people I do like, I don't really keep track of it because there doesn't need to be a narrative. Like, they are good people. They do
it's
appreciate
like a nuisance
it.
Fee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, I guess I just forget most everything that happened in the past. All right. So, that was nice. He probably didn't need to send it at 7:51 in the morning and wake me up with a text, but, either
way. You were hungover after all.
I know.
Fix Adam's do not disturb on his phone.
Yeah. I didn't have the heart to tell him I'd picked up where he'd left off.
Right.
So there was that. I also returned I showed up at work today to find both bathrooms, doors ajar, light on, fan running, which meant both had been destroyed. And I thought to myself, I had to use one or the other. So I was trying to kind of figure it out.
The pipes are groaning.
It's a weird, it's an interesting thing in that when you walk into a bathroom at an airport, you think, I'm going to intentionally not try to imbibe anything that's in this bathroom. You know, I don't want to volitionally take it in. But when you're deciding which bathroom you should walk into, and both of them have been essentially are signaling to me that there's issues. Then you have to walk in and actually take it in.
Yeah.
Like you have to weigh your options.
You have to, you know, let your nose know and walk in and actually attempt to figure out the damage in each one of those. So there was that.
Long story short, you walked to Home Depot.
I chose the one, the path of least resistance. I picked the one that seemed to be the best, and I went in there and used it. But I thought, you know, we have our bathroom etiquette thing here, and it's working pretty well. Today was kind of tough because they were both used, and they were both in the same state when I showed up. But I think we can all agree that almost a decade into my bathroom etiquette demand or decree I made here, that it works pretty nicely. No, I would argue that nobody has walked in on anyone who's ever been on the pot here, or no. At least hasn't. Look, if you think about it this way, you have two bathrooms and you have, you know, 10 or 12 people floating around this place at any given time who all seem to have bowel related issues. So those Dawson's eating a burrito as we speak, by the way. So with that in mind, the incidence of people walking in on other people that were on the commode and or at least knocking on the door, trying the doorknob, would be frequent. But if the rule is when the door is shut, someone is in there, and if you then leave, do not ever shut the door behind you, because it's going to signal to other people that someone's in there when no one's in there. Yeah. That is followed pretty rigorously around here. And so you never have that situation of waiting for the bathroom because you think someone's in there, but they're not, mm-hmm. because the door's closed. You never have the situation of someone walking in on someone mm-hmm. who's in the bathroom. And it's been, I would call it a resounding success. Highly, highly successful. So
this is going to sound like shitting on your point, but I'm actually making your point. I have been I usually lock the door when I'm using the bathroom over there. I've put many people here grab the door and try to open it. Always a guest or their entourage.
Always.
The people who have
Somebody
gotten
has been
the decree.
Up.
Yes, people have gotten the decree have adopted it.
Considering
now is the best time, by the way, because the fewer people coming in and out of the studio.
Considering the fact that it is almost everyone's worst nightmare to either be on the pot or walk in on somebody on the pot. They're both equally terrifying. I don't think nobody wants to be the person on the pot, but equally no one wants to be the person to walk in while someone is on the commode. Given that, you wonder why these aren't more universally adapted. It's very simple. It is a door closed always means there's somebody in there. If the door's closed, somebody's inside of that bathroom. If the
you
door,
know why?
Yes.
Sorry, I was just thinking why this isn't. Well, first of all, people aren't as brilliant as you. Let's start there. Okay. Next, the reason is because if people were to realize that they should have this conversation, most places do not have that sort of intelligence. Nobody wants to ask the follow-up question, which is the key to this whole thing, which is, what if it's tough stuff in there? What do we do? And that's when you do a jar with the fan. But I don't think people want to ask about that.
It is so ingrained.
They'd rather just close the door.
It is so ingrained in me. Like Maxipata, how many times you passed the door with the light on, a jar, you know, cracked a foot with the fan going and went, oh, I'm not going in there.
I do that all the time, actually, like this morning.
Yes, it's locked in. So door shut, someone in there 100% of the time. Door wide open, free and clear to enter, and a jar with the fan on, enter at your own risk. It is foolproof. It works perfectly, and everyone should adopt this. Also, I woke up today, got a... Didn't you have, Max Pat, didn't I tell you to take that article, I think, on Uppity from F1's website? Was that on your hit parade?
Yes.
So
Formula One yesterday, as we record this, they put up an article, just like Mashable did the top 20 Netflix documentaries. Formula One just released an article saying talking about 11 great F1 documentaries and films to watch during the off season, with Uppity being number two, right under Senna.
Ooh, whoa. Good company.
That's nice. And not even really F1 centric. There's probably about 4 minutes, 5 minutes in there where Willie went to Spain, I believe, to attempt to get a ride in an F1 car. So nice.
That just goes to show how much they wanted it on the list.
I think F1, we don't know it here, but the biggest sport in the world is soccer. And I think F1 may be second in the world. So nice to have that up on their website. So thanks for that, F1. Brandon is from Portland. He's driving across the country.
Hold on.
We're looking at young Sonny, young Sly, and young Frank Stallone. And
he looks more like a Stallone than Frank and Sly.
That's true. He's peak Stallone.
Yeah. I think his mom is a little nuttier than theirs, but either way, he could certainly go over there and lead a much better life than he's leading with us. That's for damn sure. Brandon, 38, from Portland. We'll put those pictures up on the website. Brandon's from Portland. He's driving across country. He's going to Florida with his kids. I've done everything, but I've never driven across country. And I always lived in California, and I felt like everyone drove across country to California. Everyone I know packed up their car in college or whatever and drove to the West, number one. Number two, I never really had a car that was capable of making it across country. And then by the time I did own a car that was capable of making it across country, I then could afford plane tickets and never thought about that. But I'd like to do that drive one of these days. Brandon, 38, Portland.
Yeah, hey there.
Yeah, hey, what's going on?
Well, thank you. I remember a few years ago, I think, you guys used to do a kid-friendly show on Wednesdays. So I don't know if that's still the case or not, but we are driving across country with my kids and trying to figure out what kid-friendly things we could listen to or try to pass the time.
How old are they?
9, 12, and 14.
Oh.
It's a tough range.
Yeah.
I would
not this fucking show.
How many days do you think you'll be in the car with them?
We're probably going to spread it out and probably take a week.
Hmm. Off the top of my head, Alex Jones does a quality podcast. I think that would help. You know, offer an alternative viewpoint to some of the stuff they're seeing on mainstream media. I would take this opportunity to expose them to good music, like the Beatles. You know what I mean? Like it's funny. Kids are interesting. Like we think that kids, you think that kids like kids music. They want the Wiggles, or they want pop shit, or whatever it is they want. Like you think they want it, but when you play them good stuff, they respond. Like
like a Max Zapata CD or something?
Sure, yeah.
Loxy, yeah.
Yeah, like you take someone like the Beatles. The Beatles are. Will work with all ages. You think it's like, I wasn't born then, or I'm too young, or I'm too old, or whatever it is. You play them some Beatles, they'll get into the Beatles. The bands that have a high quality to them, everyone, I love the Jayhawks, and I'll always play the Jayhawks for people or hanging around or driving with or whatever, and they all universally come around to enjoy it. Like when you play... You know, because music sort of operates on a level that kind of transcends your age or your education or your heritage or whatever it is. So I would definitely take it upon yourself to like expose them to some good music, unless you think the Beastie Boys are good, in which case you should definitely flop.
Skip it.
But
if you did the Beatles catalog, that's probably 10 or 11 hours of music. And it's also an interesting evolution because you start off in the mop top, you know, I Want to Hold Your Hand. It was very accessible, especially for kids. And you transition into Sgt. Pepper, the White Album, Abbey Road. Like it's a journey.
And then
by the time you get to Epcot, you're at Within You Without You.
And you pull out a couple of George Harrison singles and
a little Traveling Wilburys.
Traveling Wilburys, some Paul McCartney, you know, solo wings and solo stuff. And now you've rounded out nicely. Dawson wants to contribute.
If you really want to get into it, I got an audiobook called The Walrus Was Paul, The Great Beatle Death Clues, about the greatest hoax ever pulled in rock and roll, where they told you that Paul is dead. And there are clues all over the place. And it's a fun read, so if you really want to get into the Beatles and show your kids that you can't believe everything you hear in the news, check that audiobook out. And if you email me, Brandon, I have another audiobook by Buck Storm, a couple of them by Buck Storm. I will give you a free copy of The Miracle Man. It's a really good book. It's totally kid-friendly. It's an awesome story, and I'll just give it to you, so just shoot me an email.
Nice. Will do. I appreciate it. Those are gems. Thank you.
How long is this trip, did we figure out?
A week.
We're going to take a week.
And do you have all the places you're going to stop mapped out? Is it all mapped out?
Yes.
What kind of vehicle do you have?
We have a big Dodge truck, and then we're going to be pulling a trailer.
Wow.
Will you let people ride in the trailer while you tow it?
I would like to. I think that'd be a good way to separate the kids. I don't know if my wife would be down with that, though.
And
doesn't know.
The Dodge is a big crew cab thing, so they can just sit in the back there.
Right.
And you're pulling a trailer, so what are you doing? Are you relocating?
No, my kids race dirt bikes, and it's kind of closed down here in Portland because of Corona. So the tracks are shut down. So we're going to go to Florida and hit some of the tracks there and train for a few months.
We're driving to Florida!
Let me say this. I'm profiling your wife. On one hand, she's in her 30s and she lives in Portland.
Long-suffering.
Yeah. So, no, I'm trying to figure out the likelihood of letting the kids make a run from inside the trailer, which would be an awesome, awesome experience for them. So on one hand, she's not down with that because of the danger standpoint. On the other hand, she's willing to pack it up and go to Florida so her kids can race motocross for an extended period of time.
Mm-hmm.
So you have someone who's open to the notion of danger.
It's a complicated woman.
Yeah.
But even she has her limits.
Is she freaked out about the kids riding motocross?
She is, yeah. She gets nervous, but she's cool with it. She understands that there's risks. And I mean, every time we go to the track, we always see a big wreck and someone gets hurt. But luckily, the kids haven't had any big problems yet.
What she's class cool. are they racing?
I've got one kid on a 65 in the 65 class, and the older two are in the 85 class.
Goddamn, cool dad, man. The dads, I mean, that's how you could kind of measure the cool dads when I was growing up. The guys who had the dirt bikes and who would take the kids out and go to the desert, let them go riding on the weekends. I used to do that. As a matter of fact, the only time I ever went dirt bike riding when I was young was with the guy I paid for rehab for. So maybe I owe it to him because his dad would take us out, load up the truck, and take us out to the desert. And about the scariest thing I'd ever do is after riding these dirt bikes in the desert for a couple hours, at some point the dad would pull up back to the camp. He'd have a cigarette dangling out of his mouth. He'd be sitting on the dirt bike and he'd go, "Hey, Ad," called me Ad. "Hey, Ad, jump on. Jump on." And I'd be like, "Oh, Jesus Christ, it's the scariest thing in the world." The hairiest thing in the world is riding on the back of a dirt bike with a dude who's smoking a cigarette named Rick who wants to go out there and have a good time. And you couldn't say no.
Oh, no.
But on the other hand, it was terrifying. And much like the pilots, like when you fly with the Blue Angels, they're not doing their job unless you throw up. You know what I mean? Like,
they gotta show you a good time.
They got to scare you. A little bit. Yeah. Otherwise, that's where the fun starts. So,
well, you do the same thing with your kids. I mean, you know it.
I do it, and it's true. Like, you are in control, and the person behind you isn't in control, or the person in the car isn't in control, and that little moment of bizarre ecstasy comes for it's not when you're ramping up, you know, speeding up. And it's not when you're, you know, getting near the whoop-de-doos or the jump or the corner or whatever you are doing in the car or on the dirt bike. It's that one, it's like the millisecond where the person who's in control knows what's going on, and the person behind them or in the passenger seat is at the mercy of that mm-hmm. person. And that person who's in control knows I can let off the gas in 1 second or hit the brake in 1 second. But to the person, like, did you guys ever have that thing where you'd be driving with one of your goofball buddies in high school? Gina, this is probably a dude thing, but where they'd get in the car, there'd be like a red light with traffic going across. They'd be 200 feet away and they'd floor it and they'd go, "Oh, there's no brakes. There's no brakes." And you'd be like,
"Good
oh,
times."
And then
they'd just
stop at the last second, or they'd be speeding. God forbid they got up on a mountain road or something. They'd be speeding right for the edge, you know, like, "I can't control it." And you'd be like, and then you're both experiencing the same thing. It's just one person has control. The other person doesn't have control. And it's that one millisecond right before they brake or right before they let off.
Yes. I know it's not nowhere near the same, but the closest I've gotten is with a stroller or a grocery cart. Oh, I can't catch up to it. And he's laughing. So that's as close as I've ever gotten.
Yeah.
I'll never catch it. And he's
right into traffic.
Yeah. It's great. It's good stuff.
You
right into the milk aisle.
Push it ahead. Brian, did you have jack off buddies in high school that did like crazy driving?
Yeah, kind of, yes. But actually, I want to tell this story because I've never told this story before. Speaking of harrowing experiences on these off-road vehicles, I don't think I've ever told you guys the story. It's just never come up. But my grandparents retired to Lake Tahoe. So they lived there full time. And we'd go up and visit them several times a year, including snow season. They owned a snowmobile, and the whole family they'd take it out. They'd go to a meadow and take it out, just go all over the place. And one of the meadows had these big, I would call them craters, but you know, I was 12 years old at the time, but they were big dips. You can go down and swirl around and come up. They were huge. You could ride around in them and come up. And I went out riding with my Uncle John. I'm on the back. I'm 12 years old. He's on the front. And he's like, "Oh, look at those cool. Look at those cool dips. Those craters over there." I'm like, "Yeah, we got to do one." So we're like, "Let's go to that one over there," where there was no one for a reason. We were zooming at top speed to this crater because we want to go down and
on the snowmobile.
On the snowmobile, cruising at top speed towards the dip, you know, where we see people in other dips around this giant field going down and around. Ours didn't dip, it fell off. And we literally went like right off the edge into a little creek, ravine, whatever you want to call it, a little, like, you know, body of water that was maybe 6 inches deep. I blacked out. I was pulled out. I remember being pulled out from my back under the water, or at least, you know, water up to my face.
Wow.
By my uncle, who was, you know, bleeding here. He wore glasses.
Oh my God.
Glasses were gone. He couldn't see. He's bleeding here. We both survived. I'm 12 years old, so keep in mind, this is my recollection. It felt like an 8 to 10 foot drop. Could have been 6, but either way, that's off a speeding snowmobile. We hoofed it back to, you know, base camp where, you know, the grandparents were and everyone was, and we're like, snowmobile's pretty effed up. We're okay, but we're gonna have to go get that snowmobile. That was a life-altering experience for us.
You wrecked the snowmobile?
Yeah, upside down in a creek.
Your grandmother must have been more worried about that.
I don't remember what grandma's reaction was, actually.
Very defending your life, if people remember.
Oh, yeah.
There's a real one of the pivotal parts of that show was the snowmobile accident. I have never been on a snowmobile.
It was fun until that day.
It's super fun.
I would love to be on a snowmobile, but I have never been on a snowmobile. All right. Let's see. Jason Whitlock. Just the fact that you knew someone who owned a family member that owned a snowmobile is pretty damn
cool. We destroyed it that day.
And your grandma wasn't pissed.
She wasn't there. She was in declining health at this point, and you know, was just at home doing whatever, watching movies or something. The rest of the family went out to the field that day. You have that family member who's just like, oh, go ahead, do whatever you're going to do. I'm going to stay home and watch my shows or whatever.
I love being that family member.
Yeah, that's me. That's me. That's what I do. Do whatever you want.
Best family member.
There you go.
Well, yeah, I do have a strong element of do whatever you want and figure it out. All right, let me hit Geico, then we'll talk to Jason Whitlock. Do you own, do you rent? Well, you do one or the other, and you want to make it easy? You can bundle. Bundle your renter's or homeowner's insurance with your automotive policy, everybody. Go to geico.com, get a quote, see just how much you could save. It is easy at geico.com. Take the homeowner's insurance, take the renter's insurance, and go ahead and bundle them up with the automotive insurance at geico.com. Jason Whitlock is going to join us right after this.
And now,
sorry, Adam, just a reminder for the KFC ad, you're just tossing to it.
Yeah, no. Thanks.
And now, Alcoa presents Definitely Not a Jew on the Adam Carolla Show. Dateline, Tacoma, Washington. A 30-year-old woman was arrested at a motel with 7 pounds of methamphetamine stashed inside an accordion. Definitely not a Jew.
Well, we got Frank Stallone and Kyle Dunnigan joining us later because they both do a Killer Sly Stallone impersonation. I got some clips from the movie Cobra I've pulled up as well, so
oh,
we can
thank God.
See who can get closer to mimicking Sly in his prime. Jason Whitlock is our guest. He's got a Twitter, Whitlock Jason, also can be found now on theblaze.com. Got an article online I saw him talking about on Tucker Carlson. I think it was last night. Maybe it was the night before. Also, definitely should talk some sports because he's a former ESPN writer and Fox Sports and AOL writer and a big Kansas City Chiefs fan. So we'll get into that. It's good to talk to you, Jason.
Good to be here, Adam. Thank you.
Is are the Kansas City Chiefs, are they the odds-on favorite right now to win the Super Bowl, or is it Green Bay the favorite?
The Chiefs are the favorite. You gotta knock out the champs to be the champs, and it's great what Green Bay's doing, and Aaron Rodgers versus Patrick Mahomes would be a fantastic Super Bowl, but the Chiefs would be favored.
As a fan of the Chiefs, now they're going to be playing the Browns coming up on Sunday. I, as a Rams fan, if my team, well, I'll give you a perfect example. When the Rams lost to the Patriots in the Super Bowl 20 years ago, I thought to myself, well, I'm a Rams fan, but good for the Patriots. They've been to the Super Bowl a few times. They got their ass kicked by the Bears the last time they were here. I kind of like them growing up, and they've never won a Super Bowl, so good for them. I wanted the Rams to win, but good for them. Years later, when the Rams played the Patriots, I was like, fuck the Patriots. They've won enough. I don't want that team to win. Of course, they won both times. When you're playing the Cleveland Browns, obviously you're rooting for KC. But is there any solace if Cleveland wins to go, they're such a snake-bitten franchise, good for them?
I had no idea where you were going with that question. But you actually landed at a spot where I'm like, you know what? It actually would be kind of cool for the Browns to win in an upset and advance to the AFC Championship. And so I guess I would, because Baker Mayfield is a guy I've had mixed feelings about, undersized guy, a bit cocky, but I kind of like him. He's certainly a competitor, and it would certainly be a good look for him. So I would feel halfway decent if the Browns won.
And as I look up at all the teams that are vying for the Super Bowl at this point, the Ravens and the Titans and Cleveland and Pittsburgh.
Titans are out.
Oh, sorry. I was looking at
Pittsburgh's out.
Last week. Sorry, Max. Pat, don't put last week's up there, goofball.
Okay.
Ravens are playing the Bills.
Yeah. Sorry.
These four are the.
Yeah, sorry. The point is many of the teams that are up there either haven't won a Super Bowl or maybe have only won one Super Bowl in their franchise history.
Or tortured franchises like the Bills and the Browns.
Yeah, so it's going to be win-win because, like, you know, when the Steelers get to the Super Bowl or the Patriots get to the Super Bowl, I'm always kind of like, they've got enough. They've done enough. Most of the other teams haven't won one, or if they have, they've only won one. Yes, Brian.
Can I ask a question, especially Mr. Whitlock, but to everyone, especially Gina? I was thinking about this when I was watching the Saints, and I'm like, okay, if you're a Saints fan, are you happy with the last 15 years? So, I mean, it sounds like a silly question, but you have a great franchise, a great coach, a Hall of Fame quarterback. You've milked one championship out of it. You're a perennial contender, so that's obviously good. But are you satisfied / happy with the results? Like, should they have not gotten more out of the Drew Brees, Sean Payton combination, which is, you know, Hall of Fame worthy?
They're not remotely satisfied, primarily because of what happened to them in the NFC Championship against the Rams, where they felt like the blown call cost them a chance at the Super Bowl.
It did.
But if not for that, I think they would be kind of relatively satisfied. They, as long as Drew Brees has been there, they've been competitive and in the hunt. But having had that Super Bowl appearance in their mind stolen from, yeah, they're not satisfied. They've been on a revenge tour now. What is this, the third year trying to get that revenge?
Is speaking of Drew Brees, is he saying he's going to retire after this year, or are we speculating he's going to retire?
It's a combination of both. He has not said anything, but all indications are this is his final year, and that's what people are speculating.
And he's going to be going up against Tom Brady, combined age 147. But I like the idea that these guys at the ripe old age of 41, 42, I mean, they're
42 and 43.
42 and 43 still. Yeah,
I
really
think Brees just turned 42.
Playing lights out ball, you know, and I don't think Brady's going anywhere soon. I've not heard of him going anywhere. On the other hand, if he wins the Super Bowl, it's improbable, but if he wins the Super Bowl, should he go out? Should he just go, I'm the greatest of all time, no one's ever going to do this again?
Point.
Right.
I'm tired of predicting when Brady should go out. Clearly, he goes to his own drum, and so I've been saying he should have went out last time the Patriots won the Super Bowl. I'm not going to say that anymore. Clearly, he has a passion for football. His wife is allowing him to continue that passion for as long as he wants. Good for him. He gets to wear the pants in his house. That's kind of new territory for 2021.
and of course, I'll be rooting for my Rams against Green Bay. It's kind of tough because the Rams have this habit of playing shitty with shitty teams, aka getting beat by the Jets a few weeks ago. And then they sort of step it up against good competition. But I don't know what the spread of that game is. It's got to be 4.5 or 5, right?
6.5.
Yeah,
because it's got to be a touchdown. Derek Goff's so shitty that, you know, it's not – they don't have a chance against the Packers.
Do you mean in his current state with injuries, or do you not think much of Jared Goff as a
quarterback? No, I've never thought much of Jared Goff. I've always thought that he was overvalued. They overreacted to the Super Bowl appearance. Sean McVay's ego got involved. I created this guy. Let's pay him, and, you know, I can get this out of anybody. He's just not that good.
Is it going to be snowing in Green Bay? I was trying to figure that out, which I love a snow game. It's visually so damn compelling.
Adam, just because I look like the old school Al Roker doesn't mean I'm a weatherman.
Well, you and Gina will be rooting on the Chiefs
That's right.
this this weekend.
It says 33 degrees on Saturday, sunny, but the previous 3 days or 2 days are snow, so there could be some residual snow in the field.
Shouldn't we always just assume it's snowing in Green Bay, even if it's August? It's probably snowing in Green Bay.
It'd be nice. So, Jason, let's talk about you, former offensive lineman for Ball State, Division I school. Back
ranked in- number 23 in the country this year. Yeah, just final AP poll. Yeah, we won our conference and our bowl game.
Was there thoughts about turning pro for you?
No. There was thoughts about Apple turnovers. I was a decent, you know, I started and played, but I was not an NFL caliber player, no.
Did you know it or did someone have to tell you?
No, I knew it. I'm just a shade over 6 feet tall. And, you know, I needed to be 6'2" to be an offensive lineman in the NFL.
Did you play you must have played defense in high school, because if you're big and you're a good athlete, you'll just play on both sides of the ball.
I went to a powerhouse high school that, you know, had 4,000 students, and we were nationally ranked. No one played both ways.
Oh, really? Wow. What high school did you go to?
Occasionally I would in key games, but for the most part, no. It's Warren Central High School in Indianapolis. We won the first one in 1984. We've won 9 state titles since then and generally turn out 2 to 3 Division I prospects every year. Big time players, pros. We generally have a guy or two in the pros at all times.
Not the same as my high school.
Who would be the names we would know from that high school who went on to the pros? And
the best player we have right now is a guy at Purdue that's a wide receiver that'll be a first team All American next year. He was first team All Big Ten this year. Receiver named David Bell. We had a defensive tackle, Sheldon Day, that played on San Francisco's Super Bowl team last year. Was on the Colts this year. Trying to think of who are obviously our best NFL, most well-known NFL players. The quarterback I played with, Jeff George.
Oh, you played with Jeff George?
Yeah, we grew up together.
Comes up on their show a lot, actually.
How big was his arm back in high school? I mean, did he have a cannon in high school?
Adam, I can say this in all seriousness. In like fifth grade, we said he'll be the first pick in the NFL draft. His arm was that good as a fifth and sixth grade.
So do you guys say you won the state championship with him at quarterback?
Yeah. And finished number 9 in the country.
I'm trying to think.
He was good in high school. Awesome.
Imagine so.
Yeah, imagine he did
all
right.
There's been nobody in the NFL with a better arm. John Elway, just as good. Dan Marino, just as good. No one better.
I'm trying to think out of all the Pop Warner years I played and high school years I played. I'm trying to think. I may have gotten more out of losing than I got out of winning. I played on some good teams and I played on some shitty teams. There's a lot to get from losing. I played 7 years of Pop Warner football. I went to 2 championships each time, supremely confident we would win the game, lost each game. But I think I got a lot out of it. I don't know. You must have played peewee football, Jason.
I would analogize it more to my college experience. In high school and in junior high, played on very good teams. In college, in 1988, we played for the MAC championship at Ball State Stadium. I played very poorly against a guy named Joel Smingy that went on to have a long NFL career. And that loss has haunted me. That's 1988. How many years? Is that 35 years or however long it's been? Yeah. 32 years since. I still think about that game. I still think about, you know, how I drank too much beer and ate too much pizza. Wasn't really properly prepared as a college athlete because I just wasn't mature enough. And so I did learn a lot from that loss because that loss has haunted me.
Yeah, the thing about football, if you play an interior line position, especially if you're an offensive lineman, were you a guard?
Yeah. Guard, then also a tackle.
You can get whipped by the guy in front of you, and the same guy will usually be in front of you for the entire game, and it'll be pretty evident who got the best of who in that. And it's weird. You never forget that. I remember I played guard in high school, but I played linebacker as well. But my very distinct memory is our team sucked. We're playing Canoga Park, who was good. They had this all-league defensive lineman. His name was Ono Zwanfeld.
And,
oh, no.
Zwanfeld? I don't know what culture this child hails from.
Ono Zwanfeld was like...
a Bond villain.
Yeah, he's like a Bond villain. He's just a huge, big white guy. And Ono Zwanfeld, I think, went on to be recruited and play at UCLA. And he was like all city and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, our team sucks. Their team's heading to the championship. I got this guy, Ono Zwanfeld, in front of me the whole game. And I said, even though our team's going to lose, I'm not going to lose this battle against Ono Zwanfeld, even though the guy was a big dude and heading for UCLA. And we got down around the goal line and we ran like a dive play, and I wasn't able to get Ono out of there. And I went back to the huddle and I thought, nobody beats me. I will root him out of there. I will fire off of this ball and I will punch Ono Zwanfeld back into the end zone. And I don't care if we score or not, I'm taking care of Ono Zwanfeld on this play. And I got my 3-point stance and I fired out and Ono went nowhere. And I've never forgotten about it.
it's comical, those memories and how they stick with us. In high school, I was a very good player. I gave up one sack in my career. Guy named Chris Keevers. I can see the sack right now in my head, how he beat me. He went on to play at Purdue. He's a coach now in college football. I followed his, just because of that one sack, I followed the rest of his life.
I was literally, as I was talking about getting beat by Ono Zwanfeld, I was hearkening back to the last game I ever played as a junior in high school, where we were playing like Monroe High School. They'd gone up like 28-0 on us, and we went back to the locker room. It was the last game of the year. We sucked. And Fred Nielsen, our head coach, just looked at everyone and he said, we're not going to win this game. And everyone agreed with him, except for Michael Odom, a running back who got pissed off. And Michael Odom stood up and he said, we are going to win this goddamn game. And he like stormed out of the locker room. And then we came back in the second half, led in big part by Michael Odom, who made all these great plays. And we kind of scratched our way back into the game, it just to make it respectable. I don't think we're going to win the game. But my quarterback, who was a senior, Mike McGreecy, on the very last play of the game, he dropped back and I gave up a sack to Mike. And I've never forgot that either. I'm like, Mike's last time he touched a ball as a player, my guy sacked him. And I didn't give up many sacks either. And I was obviously still haunted to this day about it.
But I'm not trying to like one up you. I'm just sharing as you bring back memories.
Bigger fuck up. Go ahead.
Yeah. But the Joel Smingy guy that destroyed me in 1988, in 1987, at Western Michigan, I forgot the snap count. He beats me off the ball, and he sacks our quarterback, Wade Kozakowski, and ended Wade Kozakowski's career. He injured his shoulder and on the sack, and that was the end of Wade Kozakowski. I was personally responsible for ending our quarterback's career in 1987. That's something you'll never forget.
I killed a referee in 1981.
Beat
your
that.
Turn. Go ahead. I went into the stands and attacked a special needs child who was wearing the jersey of the other team.
I was in Brentwood the night Nicole. No. Oh my God.
Jesus. You're about to win.
Hey, Chris, you ever find out what happened to Ono Zwanfeld?
No, I'm trying to find him in your yearbook. See,
he didn't play on my team.
I'm looking up his name just any way I could.
But you won't find him in my yearbook because I was playing Canoga Park.
No, then I haven't found him yet.
Yeah, don't ever look in my yearbook for a guy who whooped me.
Okay, I missed that part.
he was on my all-league. He was on my all-league roster or something like that. I think he was in there. But anyway, so I guess you learn more from losing, right? Because I really don't remember almost any of the victories. That's for sure. I do remember the times I screwed up.
That is fun. I don't, you know, it's like winning the state championship in high school. I don't have as vivid of memories of that as of the poor moments I had in college or even, you know, because we had a good team in 1988 in college. And I don't have vivid memories of the victories then either. It's the losses. That's interesting. I hadn't thought about that.
But maybe that's a internalization wiring you have, and maybe that's why you've been able to go out and have success, you know, beyond your playing days. Ono's the executive vice president at CBRE, which is a real estate company.
It could be a different Ono Zwanfeld.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's kind of there's Ono.
It works with Garrick's. It works downtown. Ono, Park Street.
Ono's Zwanfeld.
I gotta see Ono.
Yeah, probably had a lot of personal momentum from kicking my ass and parlayed that into a cushy executive vice president gig. Yeah, so let's
executive vice president.
Oh, sorry. Let's think about that subject for a minute, which is I do clearly remember all the fuck ups and getting beat and. You know, I remember all that stuff and maybe not relishing the victories too much and spending a little more time reflecting. Maybe that is a quality that helps you kind of overachieve in your adult life. Maybe it puts a little fire in your belly. You know, I don't know. Jason, is any of this making sense?
I certainly spend a lot of time thinking about, I don't want to fail. Mm-hmm. And, cause I don't know, failure leaves a mark and I don't want any more marks on me. And cause I do. And I'm sitting here thinking about sports. I spend more time thinking about Joel Smingy than any other opponent and just the failure of not winning that championship. And so, you know, maybe I wouldn't call it fear of failure because I'm certainly a risk taker and I don't mind failing because I know I'll just get back up and try something else again. But I do try to take every precaution so that I don't fail. And I sit around and think about like why I'm a bit of a teetotaler. And so I don't really drink. And most it has to do with I reached to. Early in my career, I was like, hey, man, to be the best sports columnist I can't be hungover. I don't want to be sluggish when I start the day. So I don't drink that often. I used to drink like a sailor in college. But once I entered the professional world, I kind of just cut it out of my life and, you know, maybe drink 10, 12 times a year.
Well, let's not hang out, number one. I don't want to be judged. But number two... How about this analogy for everybody as it pertains to this theme we're talking about? I feel like people who work out real hard and are very much sort of look after their physicality and their aesthetic, like what they look like in a bathing suit. I feel like those people spend more time in the mirror thinking about losing 5 pounds than people that should lose 50 pounds spend time in the mirror wanting, Jason, this isn't directed at you, but
yes,
people who That's should fine. Lose 50 pounds spend like critiquing themselves. You know what I'm saying? And maybe there's some connection there. Maybe it's that fire that they sort of keep after, you know, they keep they keep under themselves. Maybe that's what that creates. I don't know, but I think if I had a wish for my kids, I would hope that they focus, not obsess, but focus on the losses and not sit and just constantly relive and celebrate the victories. Well,
yeah,
I guess coaches
always tell you 24 hours to enjoy the victory, and then we move on to something else. Well, and that's probably a good philosophy.
Your high school won the state championship, and you don't think about it nearly as much as, you know, getting beat by that tackle, right?
No question about it. I have very few, and it was our high school state championship was televised across the state. We played in the brand new, at that time, Hoosier Dome, where the Colts played. And it's hard for me to remember a single play from that game. And I've watched the game on tape, and the announcers talk about me because, you know, I was a well-known player, but I don't remember any of it. But boy, oh boy, those damn losses in college. And even when I go back to high school the year before, I screwed up in a playoff game the year before we won a state championship. I forgot my assignment. I can sit here and think about it. And you're on to something here, because the memories of the failures are really vivid.
I have one more potential failure story, and then we can talk about current events. We were at a very rare place when I was playing in high school where we were winning the game. And there was about 2 minutes left in the game. And we had the ball. And it seemed pretty apparent we were going to win this game. I think we're up by a touchdown. And I was blocking, and I got called for holding. And then I protested so much to my holding call that I got an unsportsmanlike as well. And the combined yardage on the holding call and then the 15 for the unsportsmanlike set us back to the point where our punter was standing in the end zone when it came time to punt the ball with a minute and a half left. And I was the long snapper, and it started raining. And it was dark in our end zone. It was a night game. And I was staring between my legs. And I'd played the entire game on offense and on defense. And it started raining. And I could feel it, like, on my hands as I got over the ball. And I was tired and everything. And I thought to myself, I just got a holding call. I just got an unsportsmanlike call. Now our punter's in the end zone. And if I F up this snap, I'm going to, like, single-handedly lose the game for this team. Fortunately I didn't, but unfortunately maybe now I wish I did, so I'd be even more successful now. Jason, let's talk politics, let's talk about climate, let's talk about where we're at. You recently just published an article I saw you heard you talking about on I think it was Tucker. Were you on Tucker last night? Was it the night before? I can't recall.
It's Friday.
On Friday. Oh, yeah. You know what it is? I did watch Fridays, but I watched it last night. It was in my queue. So for you, first off, being a black athlete and then a black sports writer and being at least perceived as conservative, how has that affected your standing in the community?
It depends on which community you're talking about. The social media community, controlled by the blue check mark crowd, you know, and the sports media community, you know, it's probably affected my standing in a negative fashion. It's funny. People will say, like, oh, you sold out. You're just saying that to make money. And actually, it's like, people, do you understand the business? All the money's on the other side. Everybody's getting paid to espouse liberal opinions about the sports world. That's where most of the jobs are. And there's so much heat and backlash and hostility for people that have my kind of traditional opinions and values that, that executives aren't willing to take that heat. So, you know, it's made me a bit of an outsider in the sports media world, but I was never an insider in the sports media world. I wasn't trying to be friends with everybody in the media. That wasn't important to me. I got a group of athletes and guys I grew up with or played college ball with that are my friends. I got family that, that I'm friends with. I never went into a press box. Now, again, I wasn't hostile to people, and I certainly have some friends in the media, but I could care less if everybody in the press box is a fan of mine or a friend. And then, so if you're talking beyond the media, so much of the Black community has been convinced that Blackness is determined by your political point of view. And so many people believe that liberal is a Black point of view, that it has created some tension that generally, you know, 5 years ago or 10 years ago wasn't there. You could kind of think what you wanted years ago, and no one really cared. Is were you a good person? You share religious views? Did you like sports? Things like that. But, you know, being 100% authentic and transparent with you, Adam, my mother is a hardcore Democrat, MSNBC, CNN groupie. And this current environment has put tension between me and my mother. And it's almost comical because, and I don't say this disrespectfully, but, you know, my mother is completely dependent upon me. Complete house, car, allowance, everything. But she's bothered by me not going along with the groupthink. And, you know, that's just me being completely honest. And it's just our relationship isn't as warm and fuzzy as all the time as the way it used to be or the way that I think it should be.
Well, you brought up, you know, people calling you a sellout. And there's one thing I think people should be intellectually honest about, whether you agree or disagree with Jason Whitlock or any or Scott Baio. You don't
the two titans of sports.
No, these you going against whatever LeBron James has to say doesn't get you paid. It actually takes money out of your pocket. The reality is if anyone is a sellout, it's LeBron James. It's not Jason Whitlock. It's everyone who's beating that drum. Now, I'm not saying they don't believe it, but the notion that one group profits from it and the other group oftentimes loses their job, the idea that you wouldn't call the group that fucking profits from it and all the Black Lives Matter and all that shit with LeBron James, you would then find the person that doesn't profit from him and call that person a sellout, that's patently insane. They can say they disagree all day long, that's fine, but this notion of like, you've sold out, like, you go on Fox News, you've sold out, and Fox News doesn't pay you. But if you do go on Fox News, you're not welcome on other shows. So if you have a book to promote or a podcast to promote or something to promote, you shall not. So it'll definitely hurt you financially to express those kinds of opinions. It would be the opposite of a sellout.
It's that's what's so unbelievable about the time that we live in is that so many things that are taken as fact are actually completely untrue. And it's like the opposite is actually true. And it's and so I say this all the time and it pisses people off, but I'm like, hey man, I really think we need to ask ourselves, are the liberals not the racists? They keep calling conservatives racist, but I keep finding blatant examples of liberals exhibiting racist behavior, saying racist things, and no one ever calls them racist. And it's like, I you know what? I can test this out here because I've been thinking it privately. Like, I wonder how I can express this. And in this show, I can take this chance. I think liberalism is like a condom, and you can spew all the racism you want into this condom, and somehow you're protected from it. And that's, I've never seen anything like this liberal label that allows you to do virtually anything without anybody passing judgment on you. It can be the most heinous, most racist, most anything, but it's liberal, and that person's a liberal, so look the other way. Nothing happened here.
Well, I think with racism, the first person that accuses the other person of being a racist gets some sort of impunity. And I feel like if you're, and I always make a kind of distinction.
Immunity? You think immunity or impunity?
Sorry, immunity. If I said impunity, yeah. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Immunity is what I mean, which is there's sort of two people in an elevator and the first guy to accuse the other guy of farting gets away with it. And
well, in fact, it's he who smelt it dealt it.
That's
everybody
right.
Knows
we
that.
All know this.
And I may have cut the cheese, but you licked the knife, baby.
These are immutable laws.
Yeah, so I think as long as you're sort of on the offense calling everyone a racist, the people you're calling a racist spend so much time denying they're racist, they never actually call you a racist. Although I do make a distinction between liberal and left, because I think of myself as liberal, but I do not think of myself as left. I think of myself as liberal in many facets of the definition. Whitlock, yes.
I just want to say, Jason, if you're going to expand on this idea of the condom, perhaps maybe consider calling it a contextually transmitted disease.
Yes.
You can have that.
Thank you.
Jason Whitlock. Sorry, I got Stallone waiting online, so I gotta hop here. You can check him out at Whitlock Jason. You shoot him a tweet. Also, you can read his columns available now on theblaze.com. Good to see you, Jason, as usual.
Thank you, Adam.
Appreciate it. All right. Yep. Let me tell you about KFC. Oops. Let's see. We got that. Take a break. We'll be back with Frank Stallone. First, a word from KFC.
Pretty good company there, Adam. Henry Ford, I'll take it.
Good to speak to you as per usual. The documentary Stallone, Frank, that is available Tuesday, January 19th on iTunes, Amazon Prime, Google Play as well. Congratulations on the documentary, Frank.
Well, thank you, Adam. Did you get a chance to see it?
Yes, I did. And shame on us for not loving Frank Stallone more.
Oh,
that was my takeaway, other than a very interesting documentary.
And it's fun. It's a fun documentary. Like I wanted more. I watched the whole thing. I'm like, oh, it's only an hour and 12 minutes. Let's get some more in here.
Yeah. We tried not to bring people down because, you know, sometimes documentaries about just my subject matter, everyone gets all down. So we just kind of kept it up. I mean, and the funny thing is I found out there's not one curse word in it other than mine when I got screwed out of my Oscar nomination by Barbara Streisand. That's so, and me, I'm the only one.
I mean, Frank has, you know, musician, actor, songwriter, pugilist. I mean, had an epic fight with Geraldo Rivera where you could see that Frank dominated, but really had some skill in the boxing world. Probably probably the better boxer out of the Stallone brothers?
Well, my brother's a really good puncher, but he never competed. I did. He didn't compete, but he was more of a street fighter, but he was a big puncher. I didn't like fighting because he's left-handed. And every time we fought, I got thrown off the lot. You know, we were doing Rocky III, we were sparring, and he hit me a shot in my nose, just like splattered. So I went after him. We start fighting. All of a sudden, the managers, the agents are jumping over the rope. Hey, boys, what's going on? So I was banned from the lot for like 3 weeks. I said, what did I do? He goes, you can't punch Rocky. I said, Jesus Christ, he just smashed my nose. That's showbiz.
You guys all grew up in Philadelphia, right?
Well, I grew up in Maryland. My mother got remarried when I was about 7. Then we moved to Philadelphia.
And I'm guessing that's why Rocky was set there?
Yeah. I mean, because it was kind of Philadelphia in some ways, I guess, was untouched territory. And my stepfather, who was kind of a dubious character, I guess he pulled some strings because the thing was totally shot non-union. You know, I mean, it was guerrilla filmmaking. Yeah, it's best.
How many, I know there's been the pandemic situation, but how much gigging are you doing? How much music are you playing?
None. I mean, between the pandemic and my two back surgeries, I actually was kind of good that COVID came at the time it did, because I was down for the count with all of a sudden out of nowhere, my back just went out. I had to have two surgeries and I was bad shape. So I wouldn't have been able to gig anyway, but I'm back now feeling a lot better. You know?
It was directed by Derek Wayne Johnson, who directed King of the Underdogs, which is another great doc, which is available, by the way, at chassis.com, 2 S's and a Y, my website with the docs in it. How did this thing come about?
Well, I met Derek at a club and we were talking. Someone said, you know, he just did a documentary about John Avildsen. And he was working on a documentary on your brother. I go, oh, that's interesting. I didn't know anything about that. And we just started talking and, you know, conversation back and forth. And then one day he just called me up. He goes, you know what? We want to do a documentary on your life. And I go, excuse me, me? I mean, really? Okay. And I said, are you? And then I kind of fluffed it off. I didn't hear from him a little bit. And I figured, well, it's just, jaw tackle. So anyway, after that, he got in touch with me. I said, are you serious about this? He goes, we're absolutely serious about it. So I gave my Rolodex of everyone I knew from my career that I knew. And I said, well, let's go out and see if they'll do it. And other than two people, which I'll leave nameless, they did it. And it was very surprising to me, but everyone was on board. I didn't even think my brother was going to do it, but he did.
Yeah,
like everyone who should have been in it was in it. Like who were? If you don't want to name names, that's actually up to you. But
I wanted Mickey Rourke in it.
I knew it.
No, we did Barfly, and for some reason he couldn't do it. And I wanted Carl Weathers in, and he couldn't do it. But that would have been kind of cool. But the one I wanted in the most was my bass player who died. As you can see in the movie, when I opened up his basses, I bought all his basses because I just didn't want to see them played in like, you know, a wedding band playing like Hobnin and Gila or something on like a Rickenbacker. So I bought the basses, but he would have been great in the documentary. I knew him since 1968. Well, and, you know, he died like he went. Did his gig, sat in the truck, ready to go, had a cup of coffee, bingo. That was it. Wow.
Did, you know, Mickey Rourke is probably clinically insane, but why did Carl Weathers pass?
I don't know. I mean, I didn't really get an answer. He was like on location or he was busy or something like that.
A logistics issue.
Huh?
Hopefully a logistics issue.
Hopefully, yeah. I mean, I would have loved to see him in it. I mean, he's part of the, you know, kind of the Stallone history, I guess, with the movies.
So you say you didn't think your brother would do it.
Well, no, I didn't. I didn't think he would do it because it was like, you know, it was a little far-fetched, to say the least. And then he said, yeah, I'll do it, you know, why not? And I said, once he did it, and then Arnold did it, not that it wasn't legitimate to begin with, but it gave a thing of legitimacy, you know, because like always when actors, they always say, so we want you to do this movie. It's not a big movie. Well, who's in it?
Right.
So if it's like, you know, Ishka Bibble, no one's going to do the movie. But if it's like, you know, oh, well, you know, this guy's going to do it or this guy's going to do it. That's fairly well known. People go, oh, well, if they're going to do it, I'll do it. You know,
how's the relationship with Sly these days?
Oh, great. It's so much better because he moved. He packed up and moved to Palm Beach. And he's got a great house there. He's got his own beach. And he's here now, and he hates it. He's had to come back to do some stuff, and he said, I just can't wait to get back because he loves Palm Beach. You know, that he's always liked Florida. He went to school in Florida, you know, and he just likes it there. It's real loose. You know, I mean, I was there to visit. I didn't see one gum wrapper. I didn't see one piece of trash on the street. I didn't see any homeless. I didn't see anything. It's just people kind of just doing their thing, biking and just hanging out.
I'm going to be in Naples, Florida, off the hook this weekend, by the way, January 15th, 16th. Nice. We're doing stand-up there. I don't think I've ever been to Naples.
Naples is beautiful. Really nice. Very high-end, very expensive, very nice.
So you said Sly went to school in Florida?
Yeah, he went to the University of Miami. Yeah.
Oh, I don't know why I didn't know that. See, did he graduate college?
None of us graduated. I didn't graduate high school. He didn't graduate college. I finished high school at 23 years old. You know, I mean, we were not academically. I mean, we weren't stupid. I mean, as you can see, that's like maybe an eighth of the books I have. And it's like three more shelves up, but I have probably 2,000 books in my house. But that's how I educate myself. I just found that stuff I wanted to know and then read it, you know.
I will say this. I will commend you because I was watching television. Everyone's doing the Zoom thing now, and half the people you see have a wall of books behind them, and then the other half have a guitar or two behind them.
Both, yeah, exactly.
Like Gina, both signaling that they're better than I am. And I thought to myself literally last night, I should get a wall of books and put some guitars there so people think I'm a winner.
And Gina, you don't have any books behind you, do you?
That's true. We don't. In the other room.
Bookless, but guitars.
But I thought if someone combined the two, there would be the ultimate winner. And Frank Stallone has made that dream come true for me because I'm counting two or three guitars.
I wasn't going to do the gold records, but.
Oh, and the gold records.
Don't even try.
We could do that wall. But that's kind of over the top.
What year were those gold records from?
Too long ago to remember. Probably when Rudy Valley was singing. I think, 80s, you know, Rocky, Staying Alive, around that period.
Was the, you got to work on the Rocky series and many other things, and you were in them, and you did the music for them, and got you a lot of accolades and all that. On the other hand, there's always the association with your brother and probably some feeling like, oh, he's throwing you a bone. When in fact, obviously you're legitimate. What are we looking at?
We're looking at Frank
my brother, and Sly. It says the first picture is when my brother was filming Rocky, my first trip to LA, 1975. Yeah. And then there's another picture at a meat factory filming Rocky Balboa, the premiere of Expendables 2. I'm blessed.
But blessing or curse having a Sly for a brother? I mean,
well, it's a blessing I have him for a brother, and it's a blessing that I was able to be involved in the movies, but it wasn't a blessing like basically how I was treated by the press. I mean, I'd been a working musician by the time Rocky came out for like 11 years. I started in 1965. And the thing was, I loved the movie. I was happy to do it, and it was great. But then all of a sudden, things turned. I went from Frank Stallone to Rocky's brother. And it was like, really, even when I got shot, it wasn't Rocky. They have a picture of Sly as Rambo. Rambo's brother shot, and he's not happy about it. I mean, come on, man. Like 70 stitches in my hand. It's like, well, they didn't even mention my name. It's Rambo's brother shot, and he's mad about it.
I want you to tell that story, but I do also want to say, you know, it's funny. As a society, we have such a itchy trigger finger for nepotism. Like, we love going, oh, that guy was born on third base and thought he hit a triple, or that guy wouldn't be who he was if he didn't know, or if his daddy, his daddy's a senator. Now he's, you know, we love.
What are you talking about?
That's my son. That's right. But he's going to be a loser.
It's you know what it is, though? It's genetics. I mean, if you think about it, look at Bill Walton. His son's a great basketball player. Look at Ringo Starr. His son's a great drummer. John Bonham's son's a great drummer. But it's genes. I mean, if you look at horse racing or any kind of breeding, they breed because of genetics. My brother and I are from the same gene pool. So, but there is something to that. I mean, it's just they don't allow two people to be successful.
Well, it's business.
I want to say, A, I totally agree with that analogy, and B, thank you for just making it about white people. Otherwise, we'd be fucked. So, yeah, it's genetics. But what I'm saying is we live in a totally catty society.
Yeah.
And we love, I've sort of figured out, it's like the war on successful people or the war on rich people that's going on. We love to go, oh, that person's just this way because they got that thing. Or,
exactly.
And now we just go, oh, that person's rich or that person's white. What do they know? Or what do they know about working hard or any of that stuff? But so you experienced that for sure because of our horrible wiring as a society to go, if his brother wasn't Sylvester Stallone, would we even know who he was? So you've had to deal with that your whole life.
Adam, I got hammered because it wasn't like, that's so-and-so's Glenn Ford's daughter. But that's different because they're like old by that point when their kids are going into business. My brother and I are only 4 years apart. So it was like a collision. My first album came out and Rocky came out. I don't care if the Eagles, Hotel California came out. Nothing could have eclipsed Rocky. It was just one of those things. That happens maybe one out of a billion times that the people just went crazy. And I got caught up in the thing. I mean, I didn't know anything. I was living in an $80 a month apartment in Trenton with a local band. I didn't know, go on the Mike Douglas show. But that's the thing. It's really funny. All of a sudden, I lived in this ghetto in Trenton, $80 a month apartment. And all of a sudden, I'm on Dinah Shore show, Burke Griffin show, the Mike Douglas show, and this. All these big shows, and they would do this. It was great. Oh, Frank Stallone, great. That's great to have you out. Yes, band sounds good. This would be the first thing. So what's it like being Rocky's brother?
Right.
Everyone. So in other words, I was the intel. Since they couldn't get him, I was like the cannon fodder and that stuff.
Well, I hate to perpetuate this, but Kyle Dunnigan is on the line, and Kyle's a comedian who does a pretty killer Sylvester Stallone. Kyle,
he looks like he was in a fire. Oh, there he is. How you doing?
All right, we got to
mute off.
Unmute you, Kyle. Sly, unmute yourself. Let's see if we can. No, still
hear muted, Mr. Stallone.
Is this a real guy or is this like a puppet? Is this a real guy?
There he is.
Talking about Frank, real guy. It's my baby brother right there, playing pranks.
You sure it's not Roy Scheider?
Hey, look at this. Look at this. Isn't he funny? Baby brother making jokes. Look at that. Two Stallones. This is almost like too many Stallones,
Very rare. Sly, I do appreciate you being in the dock. I know, you probably did it with some apprehension.
What do you mean in the dock?
The documentary, Stallone.
About your brother.
Frank. Why you got to shorten all words? You're always shortening words. I know what you're talking about.
Listen, after the show, I'll take you out for some froyo, and I'll explain it to you.
What the hell's this? Froyo?
Al Pacino and Sensible Woman.
Hey, Frank, you want to go? Look at this guy. He was always busting my balls as a kid. Imagine your baby brother busting your balls. So, it's not right.
Now, did you, when you have
Frank was a handsome one too, so it wasn't fair.
When you're initially asked to be in the documentary, Frank's documentary,
Thank you for using the entire word, Mr. Carreau.
Sorry. Were you excited about it? Did you need to sleep on it? Did you need to be talked into it?
Look, Frank asks me to do something, I do it. Mm-hmm. Understand? You understand the brotherly love is strong. Mm. If Frank asked me to bury a body, I bury the body.
Wow.
No questions asked. I'd have to think twice about it. I did the doc right away.
Did you, this may be a little intimate, but you ever share the love of the same woman? I feel like that would have been something.
I don't know how much Frank wants me to reveal here, but one time, this is a pretty funny story. We had a girl with the, I think they call it a pig roast. Now,
oh boy.
Oh my God.
I don't know. Is this too much?
No. Go ahead.
He says fine.
Remember that, Frank? He's smiling. He remembers. Look at Frank. He remembers. Look at that smile. I love that smile. It brings me joy.
I'm not familiar with pig roast. It's like
finger cuffs, Mr. Stallone.
Like putting a pig on a spit.
Yeah. Maybe you know it as pig roll.
Where did this happen, Sly?
What's that?
Where did this happen, Sly?
Oh, look at this acting all innocent, like he doesn't remember. We were in the Cape there. We're having a good time. Everyone's having a nice time. The funny thing was, in the middle of it, we realized we were related to this woman, Maria. A direct cousin.
Oh no.
And the thing was, she knew the whole time, which is disturbing. Me and Frank, we don't know. We're just having a good time.
That came up in the middle of this activity?
Yeah, was there a lot of chit chat?
Well, you know, people are into different things. This young lady was into, you know, relatives. Some people like feet.
Some she had people a family like tree fetish.
We didn't consummate the relationship, did we?
What's that?
We didn't consummate.
Frank, you were hammered. He doesn't even remember. No, we did not finish.
Oh, my.
We did not finish.
Oh, halfway.
Yeah, that's right. You say, you know, this is a little too much for us. We're classy guys. You know, Italians are classy, but the Italian ladies aren't classy. People don't know this, but that's part of the culture.
We were talking to Frank before about who would win in a fight. He said you had a pretty good left, but he was a more experienced boxer.
Yeah, no, Frankie's a great boxer. Absolutely. Absolutely great boxer. I don't do defense. If you see Rocky, you see there's no defense.
Right.
I'm going for the punch, the one punch knockout. But Frank's got all the different, you know, he blocks, you know. He beat the crap out of Geraldo Rivera. You remember that, Frank?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I went in there. I don't know. Well, you know, Adam, you boxed a little bit. You know what I mean? I came in with really bad bruised ribs the first day of training. And they take like a year to heal. And it's so horrible. If someone just went, bink, you fall down. And I go, I got to fight this guy in 2 weeks. My brother goes, hey, you know, he's a news reporter. You can't lose, you know. Makes us look bad. So I'm getting all this pressure and everything. I go to the gym in New York. These mob guys come up. Hey, you're going to kick his ass, you know, because he did an expose on the organized crime. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going, wait a second. This is, if I lose, maybe I'll get killed, you know. So they're shooting my ribs up with Novocaine. So I go in there and I'm not fighting like I normally would because I'm very conscious of that. Mm-hmm. And it was just, you know, one of those things. I hadn't been in the ring in 12 years. And, you know, they said I could fight with 10 ounce gloves and no headgear. I figure I was a pretty good puncher, catch him on the chin. But then I got there and said to wear 16 ounce gloves with headgear, which changed the whole ball game.
Yeah, that was
so stupid. I mean, I don't even know why I did it. I was like 41 years old or something.
You did fantastic. And it was for charity. It was like, I think it wasn't for like, you know, mentally handicapped charity, something like that. So it's doing a nice thing. And I'll tell you this, that Frank, you hit him so good. I think there was one more mentally handicapped person in the world after that fight. And it was Geraldo Rivera.
Touching words.
Hey, Sly, we know, obviously you're Sly Stallone. So, you know how to handle yourself, but I should say Sly's going to join us at Naples this Friday, by the way.
Oh, yes.
Live podcast.
Right.
Not your Sly, our Sly.
Yeah,
although, if you're Sly, how far is Naples from West Palm? Where's your brother? In West Palm?
Palm Beach.
Palm Beach.
Which is kind of next door to each other.
You blow a call into him, see if he wants to swing by the
Naples
club and join us at Naples.
Who's this fake Sly we're talking about?
Yeah, it's not worth getting into. But I know
Adam,
Frank.
Who did you watch the film with?
I watch it alone. I got a link and I watched it last night before I came in or before.
Was this something you expected or were there any surprises for you or anything like that?
I know you well. Yeah. Or fairly well. I consider you a friend. Yes. And I was just kind of ashamed of myself for not having as much respect for you and your career and your accomplishments as I had in my own head. I had rounded down when I shouldn't have, and I was guilty of maybe the same thing most of America is guilty of, which is like, when you really get to know somebody, especially via documentary, you really get to know the nuances of the person and also how sort of faceted people are. And in your brain, it's always just this fast pass thing of like, that person's related to that person or that person does a little this or a little that. And I thought it was a great documentary, Sylvester.
Absolutely. He's very, very talented. Yeah. Grammy nominated, Golden Globe nominated. You should have won both.
You attack me for saying doc instead of documentary, but you, Sylvester, answer to Sly.
That's very interesting.
It's a good point.
That's really exploding my brain right now, you know? Like I'm having to deeply think about this.
That forlorn look in his face.
I know Frank.
You know it well.
Frank does a great.
He's very cute.
Frank does a great impersonation of you, Sylvester.
I don't think he's that good. I don't think he's that. Doesn't sound like me. Go ahead, do it, Frank. You do it, and then I'll do me. And you.
But I don't do it. I don't actually do it as Rocky. I do it like more like how he talks.
Yeah, that's how I talk.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's how it's done, Frank.
This show is confusing.
Sly wouldn't talk as punchy as Rocky, you know? So he'd be like, hey, brother, listen, today when you do the interviews, you know, just be careful. You know what I mean? Sometimes the guys, so he was almost like Vito Corleone, like when he was telling his sons, you know, be careful. Like, talk about you. But so far, they've all been good. Everyone's been really, really nice.
You didn't talk about my whisper, Frank.
Your what?
You left out my intense whispers. When I talk to you like this.
Oh.
Left that
really
out. That's
gets
all.
In your ear.
Continue. Continue, Frank.
Well, I have a good tiebreaker here because I pulled a bunch of clips from my favorite Sylvester Stallone movie, Cobra.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. The best film.
I actually like Cobra.
I like Cobra too, and we don't have
Cobra.
We don't have any clips from Rocky. We have Cobra, so I'll play the first one, and we'll see who can sound more like Stallone. Is it
cure the disease and I'm the cure?
All right, let's go. This is gonna be brother versus brother.
This the grocery store confrontation. Here we go.
I got a bomb here. I'll blow this whole place up.
Go ahead. I don't shop here. Hey, just relax, amigo. You want to talk? We'll talk. I'm a sucker for good conversation.
I don't want to talk to you. Now, you bring in the television cameras in here now. Come on, bring it in.
Can't do that.
Why?
I don't deal with psychos. I put him away.
I ain't no psycho, man. I'm a hero.
You're a disease, and I'm the cure.
Die!
Hey!
Drop it!
All right. I think we got a good idea.
There you go. Yeah, you know what? You know what I watched last night and I hadn't seen for a while? I thought was really underrated was Get Carter.
Oh, I haven't even seen Get Carter.
Get Carter's kind of like that. He's done some cool ones like ICU. The ones that kind of fall under, well, Nighthawks was a great one.
Sure.
Rhinestone. Come on, Frank.
Did you
stop
like
or my mom will shoot you.
Yes. Yeah, that was,
is that what it's called?
That was a great one. Yeah. Rhinestone and Stop My Mom Will Shoot.
Frank talked me into both those films. He said, you got to see Dolly's Cans. And I was like, I'll check them out. And then we decided this would be a great film.
You guys didn't pull a luau on her, did you?
No, come on.
Yes. We tried to, believe me.
We didn't do a pig roast, right?
We didn't. Well, look, we tried. We tried our best. That's a beautiful, talented woman, Dolly Parton. Hard to resist. Mm.
I'll play a shorter clip from Cobra.
Yeah, you're playing the whole movie. Yeah.
Well, I probably didn't need the lead-in part where he was like running across. You know, probably.
But how
really
great.
Got through the dialogue. You know what? It looks like a low-budget movie, which makes it kind of cool.
Yeah.
It's kind of like art house. It's like my favorite movie that he's ever done, and it's so sick, and I know no one even knows of it, is Death Race 2000.
Oh, yeah.
Death Race 2000.
Machine Gun Joe for Turbo.
That's right.
And he has the switchblades, giant switchblades in front of his car. And in the races, you just see how many people you can kill on this, like, 500-mile race.
No one knows that film.
I know that film.
Beautiful brother Frank.
Yeah. All right, we'll play one more clip from Cobra.
There's no question that it's the same weapon.
90% sure it's the identical weapon. Mutilating cuts, straight, long, deep, just like the others.
That brings the count to 16, and still this bastard shows no distinct pattern.
Well, maybe there's more than one killer.
Hey, look, this is not your specialty, okay? This is pure investigative police work, not jumping through a window.
I think what we need is to beef up the task force.
What we need is some interagency cooperation. Christ, every department wants to be the damn hero in this case.
Captain, look, I don't want to be a hero. I just want to get involved, all right?
Hmm.
You want to show Lawrence of Arabia next? You're showing the entire film here. I thought we were doing quotes.
Yeah.
Well, there's a great quote from the first when we watched, not just the "You're the disease, I'm the cure," but "Go ahead, I don't shop here."
Oh yeah, let's go.
Great line.
Let's try that.
Classic. No, that's that's like those Clint Eastwood lines. You know, they're just classic.
You want to try it, Sylvester?
Yeah. Well, I could. We go. Maybe we'll see who says it more like me.
Okay.
Or Frank. You want to do that, Frank?
All right.
Frank had actually a couple of lines. They ended up on the editing room floor, but he said, why don't you say, hey, I like shopping here sometimes, but not today because there aren't very good deals.
It's a little wordy.
Didn't flow as nice.
I don't shop here.
All right, so it's go ahead. I don't shop here. Let me hear.
Go ahead, Frank. Go ahead, Frank.
Go ahead. I don't shop here.
All right, now here's me. Keep what, remember what Frank did, but here's me, okay. Go ahead. I don't show you. You know?
You know? And a little more gravitas.
Sounds like the Gabby Hayes version.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very underrated, Gabby.
Kind of, you kind of petered out a little bit at the end there, Sly.
Let me try that again.
All right, try it again.
Let me do Frank's line. We do Frank's line?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I don't shop here all the time, but sometimes I do if they got good deals, which they do mostly on Sunday, but you got to bring a coupon, you know?
Wow, I got chills.
That's the part that cut him out?
That was on the cutting floor.
Yeah, but you got some other great lines got in the films, Frank. That one just was, that one was a miss, unfortunately.
Oh, I see. He was writing for the film. Is what
yeah, you
said,
know, he yeah. comes up with good lines.
He's punching. Were there any other punch up he had that didn't make the cut?
Yeah, well, he got a close. He gave us the idea for when Drago, I say to him, he says, I must break you. And then I say, go for it. Right. So Frank said, what if you go after Drago says, I must break you, say, all right, well, why don't you try? But I don't think that will work that well because I've been working out a lot, you know?
See, Frank's stuff was a little wordy.
Yeah. It was too wordy.
What do you think about Danny Aiello? I mean, how about when he goes, hey, Frank's like you don't hear guys talk about a five-tool guy.
Yeah.
You can sing, you can dance, you can. But that's like a Damon Runyon thing. Yeah, the guy's a five-tool guy, you
that's
know?
That's right.
Poor Danny, I loved him. He was a great guy, man. He really a great guy. Loved
that's
him.
Right. I would see Frank. He's singing. Always singing at home. Music, playing music, guitar, dancing. He was the entertainer. Am I right, Frank? You were the entertainer.
Yes.
That's right.
I was the entertainer. You know, it's funny. Like, I look at my mother in there. She's 98 in there in the movie.
Wow.
She just passed away. She was a month shy of 99, still drove everything. Yeah, still drove, did Pilates, played the piano every day, piano lessons. So my piano player teaches. So he went over to my mother's house. And he's British. He goes, right, how long's your mom been playing? Like 3-4 months? I go, no, I hate to tell you, like 70 years. And she still couldn't play a song, but it was great. But she did it.
Hey, Sly.
She played longer than Vladimir Horowitz. You know what I mean?
Frank is the entertainer. Frank is the singer. But I think you did some singing, maybe in Rhinestone.
Oh, sure. Yeah, with Dolly. Yeah.
I did some, you know, I did get some talent. If you have any of the clips of me singing in Rhinestone, I would appreciate you playing that because I don't know where it came from. Probably from Frank, you know. I had some in my DNA, some talents. And he did help me with that. Is that right, Frank? Help me sing.
Yeah, a little
bit. Yeah. What was that song? The one with Frankenstein beer song? What was that one?
I have no idea.
Frank,
I only saw like a quarter of the movie.
How bad a singer is your brother, Frank?
He's not that good. I mean, but he'll be the first one to admit it.
You talk like I'm not even here, Frank.
What happened?
Say to my face. Come on. Say to my face. At least have the dignity and the respect.
I was living in New Jersey, and they offered me $5,000, which I'd never seen $1,000 in my life. I was so broke to come out and sing the title for Paradise Alley. So they flew me out, man. Everything was really cool. And then when I got here, they go, they changed their mind. They want Sly to sing it. So he got, poor guy got murdered because movie written by Sylvester Stallone, starring Sylvester Stallone, directed by Sylvester Stallone, title song by Sylvester Stallone. And I said, why did they fly me out? Like, why do they want you to do it? I thought it'd be good, you know? And it was, oh man. And I loved the movie. But
was that the follow-up to Rocky? That was the first movie after Rocky?
No, the first movie after Rocky was Fist.
Oh,
which
that's
thought
right.
Was a great movie. Yeah, and then Paradise Alley, and then he was, and then after that, Rocky II, which kind of brought him back up. But those were good times. I remember, you know, I remember a lot of good times. I mean, like staying alive was the best time in my life because that was a culmination of like 18 years of failure and then getting a chance to like really do something, you know.
Slide.
Don't you feel like, Frank, that Adam Carolla stole Rocky when he made the hammer? Don't you feel like that was a complete ripoff?
No.
It's getting uncomfortable.
You know?
No, I like the hammer. He gave it to me. I wish you would have fought Geraldo, but easier than you're younger than me. Lay the hammer on him.
I think Adam can fight, right? Adam, can't you fight pretty good?
Adam can fight. Of course, he knows how to fight.
In my younger days. Yeah. Used to be a trainer. Sure, Sly.
Did you ever go to the Left Hook Gym in Canoga Park?
No, I went to the Montoya Gym or the Olympic Gym in downtown.
The Olympic Gym was the best, man. That was old. That's where Rocky shot, first one.
Oh, was gym. It? Was it? It was a totally old school gym that
upstairs.
Was. Yeah, it was on Hope Street in downtown. Yeah. It was right behind the Olympic Auditorium. It was called the Hope Street Gym. It was called the Olympic Gym. It was called the Montoya Gym.
So he was at the Main Street Gym.
Oh, at the Main Street Gym.
The Main Street Gym, like when he's going like that, right? Get you the cracker. And like Roberto Duran and all. It was like about 20 heavy bags, 2 rings. Old gym. It was great. Well, and the Olympic Gym was right behind the Olympic, right? Right behind the Olympic Auditorium, right?
Right. Like,
remember that one too.
Parking lot away. Wait, were you just doing Burgess Meredith there?
Who, me?
Frank? Yeah.
Oh, get your little chicken asses out. No.
Yeah, do it. And then
I don't really know how to do.
Sly, you could respond.
Oh, that's right. Hey, Mick. What do you don't like come to my place? My place stink? You think it stinks?
Weakened legs.
Oh, come on, but this girl's got nice cans. Come on, Mick.
You're gonna crap like thunder.
Whatever that was.
But I should get a laxative. That sounds terrible.
You gonna shit lightning and crap like thunder. Something like that. I don't know.
You gonna eat a lot of food and then have a problem in the toilet, was the original Ryan Frank wrote.
Yeah, it was. It was.
We had a good time as a kid, me and Frank, too, didn't we?
Growing up. So I'm kind of looking forward to this thing coming out, see how people react to it.
I think, judging from it, the reaction can only be positive. I don't know if it's gotten any Rotten Tomatoes scores. What do we think? Oh, curious if it has any Rotten Tomatoes. The audience had to love it. I'm sure the critics did too.
Is Rotten Tomatoes good, or is that like the Razzie Awards? Or
no, it's good.
It's just a rating system.
What do you think the lowest Sly Stallone movie is on Rotten Tomatoes? Is it
Stop or My Mom Will Shoot?
It's not Rhinestone.
Rhinestone's there, but Stop My Mom Shoot got really hammered. I didn't see the whole movie, so I don't really know.
You only thing I have the is whole sport movie? Jacket.
Yeah.
Well. I haven't looked up Stop My Mom Will Shoot, but it's at least going to be a tie because Staying Alive from 1983, it's at zero.
Zero tomatoes?
Yes,
What's that mean? That means like the worst it can be?
They weren't fans.
No tomatoes at
yes,
all?
Until they implement the minus tomato, it is
God.
As low as it can go.
Oh,
might be
my
a
God.
0.5 my, tomato and they round it down. You don't have to be
my
negative.
My breakthrough movie that changed my life didn't even get a tomato.
Oh, I forgot about The Specialist. That's at 7%. Stop or My Mom Will Shoot is 7% as well.
Is that
my
good
favorite?
Or bad?
It's not great.
None of it's good.
It's a 1 to 100 scale.
Well, yeah. How do they rate it? If you get 10 tomatoes, is that good or bad?
No, you want to be above 60 tomatoes.
It's a weird, it's a percentage thing.
So
but
where I was Staying Alive at zero is like the worst it can get.
Who wants 100 tomatoes?
And I'm
is that like the worst?
Many.
Is that
you
the
get
worst
heartburn.
You get at 100, a zero?
It's a percentage thing. Well, look at it as a math test. 100% is great. 60% is not so good, but passable.
Zero.
You were sick that day.
My God. I didn't know that. Wow.
You gotta repeat. All right.
I wonder what Rocky got. Yeah, probably good.
Oh, Rocky's gotta be high.
90s.
I want to give a plug to Frank Stallone and the movie Stallone. Frank, that is. Very good documentary. Lots of great names in it. And eye-opening, I would call it. It's available Tuesday, January 19th on iTunes, Amazon Prime, and Google Play as well. So check that out. Frank, thanks so much for joining us.
Adam, thank Always. You, guys. It was great. I'll see you in Palm Beach.
Hey, we'll see you. And be nice to the Kerp, would you, Frank?
I will.
All right, good.
All right.
He's a good guy.
All right,
you, Frank. Guys. Lots of love, Frank.
Thank you.
Lots of love. There's my little baby brother.
Well, love that guy. Let's see. Kyle, hang around. We'll do the news.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gina Grad. Breaking viral. All those crazy Trump tweets. Give me news with Gina Grad. Trouble in the Middle East. Celebrity drunk meltdowns. Need news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
Well, as we mentioned yesterday, an internal FBI bulletin says armed protests are being planned at all 50 state capitals on Inauguration Day. That's as well as the U.S. Capitol. According to the FBI, it's also received recent information about a group asking for the storming of the state, local and federal government buildings and courthouses if Donald Trump is removed from office before Inauguration Day. And meanwhile, crowdfunding website GoFundMe is banning people from raising money to fund travel expenses for political events following riots. But the thing that really stood out is Adam, I think this is a guy you might be jealous of and definitely cannot relate to. A U.S. Capitol rioter caught on camera clutching disposable restraints while wearing paramilitary gear is a former bartender from Nashville who stormed the Senate with his mom, according to a report on Sunday. Oh. Yeah. 30-year-old Eric Munchell photographed holding the zip tie like handcuffs while he climbed over press gallery chairs, said he and his 57-year-old mother, Lisa Eisenhart, breached the building. Eisenhart is a nurse. She said she and her son drove from Tennessee to fight the powers that be, including the press and liberal elected officials.
Well, definitely not a Jew. Number one. Number two, I started hearing about zip ties and pipe bombs, and this thing officially got scary. Now, I know everyone was scared before I was scared, but pipe bombs and zip ties, that is fucking, that's hideous.
The devices, yeah, were supposedly like working devices that just didn't go off.
Don't forget to bring your zip ties. Well, she was mommy about
thanks,
it.
Mom.
Well, yeah.
I have a mom.
Mom. God. I gassed up the Oldsmobile. Did you get time off the nursing job?
I did. Mom.
Yeah, I got a pipe bomb and I got the zip ties. Now we're going to go over there and implement a little frontier justice.
I put wax on the fuse. It works.
Okay. I'm not, no one's critiquing you. Did you get the duct tape?
Yes, God.
Okay. You're kind of whiny for an anarchist.
Oh, my God.
I'm not saying that Dad made the right decision all those years ago, but I think there's a reason he's not here. Now, I asked you.
Glad he left.
Did you bring the box of flares?
Oh, my God. Stop. I have them.
Okay, Mom. Sorry. And by the way, it's going to be a long drive, and I know you're a registered nurse. And if you put your hand on my goddamn wrist to get my pulse more than every 70 miles, I will fucking open up a can of whoop-ass on you inside that Oldsmobile. And scene. All right, Gina, sorry.
Well, to your point about the bomb mechanism stuff, they're still trying to figure out if that was supposed to be a diversion or if they were there to actually take hostages. This is all being investigated. The TSA, as we know, is involved with a no-fly list, but this is affecting others as well. So, you know how President Trump was very excited about giving the Medal of Freedom to Bill Belichick? Bill is not interested. Mm. He is turning down the medal. He issued a statement Monday explaining his decision. He said, "Recently, I was offered the opportunity to receive the Presidential Medal of Freedom, which I was flattered by out of respect for what the honor represents and admiration for prior recipients. Subsequently, the tragic events of last week occurred and the decision has been made not to move forward with the award." And he also said, "Continuing the efforts of social justice, equality, and human rights while remaining true to the people, team, and country I love outweigh the benefits of any individual award."
I know Kyle does a killer Bill Belichick, so I think he should just read that statement.
How does Bill Belichick sound?
No one's ever heard him speak. Only
is that right? More than a full sentence at a time.
Oh, okay.
Just one of the mama-sans at Orchids of Asia. That's the only time. That's the only time he speaks. He's done 7,000 press conferences, never uttered a word.
He talks like this.
That's his stock and trade. I think everyone and Bill has probably realized that what's he got? 6.5 more days,
right.
And then that'll be that. Like, who the hell would want to be in a photo op with Trump? With first off, Bill Belichick is in a profession where 74% of the people he works with are African American. You know what I mean? Like, he's got to return. He's got to get on that team bus.
Right.
And does anyone want pictures of Donald Trump putting a medallion over your head and shaking hands and smiling?
It's radioactive.
Like, yes. Everyone has just got to be like, there's 6.5 more days. They're not going to fucking go near there.
I think you take it. Because when you die, that's what they say. The awards. That's on the list. And they forget where you got him.
Maybe I'm naive. You guys cut this up for me. What's in it for Trump to offer on the medal at this point? Like, I mean, not what's in it, but I mean, what is the stated motivation? You're just a real good coach and a hell of a guy. So as my last act as president, come on over here and get this. I'm naive.
I would assume, though this is just speculation, that when you're down like he is right now, you try and pull in any friend you can find. And if you want to bribe him with a medal, you bribe him with a medal. And when that person says no, then you rolled the dice and it didn't work out.
He probably told him 17 years ago, if I'm ever president, what would that conversation sound like between Bill Belichick and Donald Trump from 2004, Kyle Dunnigan, where he jokingly promised him to give him the medal if he ever became
hammered.
President. Mm-hmm.
Hey, Bill, I got one. I'm ever president, pretty likely. The way things are going, I'll give you a medal. How's that sound?
Sounds great.
Yeah. And don't turn it down. Be a douche. That's a douche move. If ever I become president and then you turn it down, that would be you being a douchebag. Would you agree?
You said it.
Okay. Terrific. And scene.
He's never said more than three words in a row.
I think he probably promised him many years ago he would do it for him. That's my speculation.
There's a little more family strife because at this point, Ivanka said she will attend the inauguration, and Dad isn't super thrilled about that.
Why would she be invited?
Well, I think wouldn't they all be invited?
Does she have an official role? Does she have like a title?
Yeah. She's part of the administration, isn't she? I mean, she's not just the daughter.
She's princess.
She's duchess. No, but they are invited and nobody else is planning on going. But the thinking is that she feels that she has a political career ahead of herself. And, you know, why not, you know, shake hands and kiss babies and be sort of more available.
Great boobs.
Great boobs. Great jaw structure. Makes sense.
Yeah, kind of. I'm like, I feel like, I don't think she's going to get hurt politically for not showing up, although she might score some points for showing up. Like, I really don't know. I will say, after doing Celebrity Apprentice, when I was done with that show, I was so impressed with her. Like, I just thought she was so on top of everything. She was totally eloquent and clear. Like, she had this great sort of business mind. Like, you know, obviously this is pre-Trump presidential whispers even. But at the end of that experience, I was like, she has it going on. This chick is competent. Like, she just kind of owned it when she walked in, but not in an arrogant way. And I wouldn't be surprised if she was thinking about some sort of political future.
Yeah. And if that is her thinking, I would imagine she would be thinking, if I go to the inauguration, I'm not going to lose anyone who already supports me, but I could definitely gain a few fans, you know, just by being the one reaching across the aisle. So we'll see. It's still not, I think someone under her said, like, what are you talking about? She's not going, but the rumor is she's the only one in the family that will be going, and Donald's not super excited about it.
Yeah.
Ask and ye shall receive. We have some hot off the press Brendan Fraser news.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Sent to all of you, then I don't know how you missed it. So we were trying to figure out where in the hell is Brendan Fraser? Well, he's here, 52 years old, by the way. He's teaming up with director Darren Aronofsky to star as a morbidly obese recluse in The Whale, according to Variety. The film, which is an adaptation of Samuel D. Hunter's play, focuses on a 600-pound middle-aged man, Charlie, who's attempting to reconnect with his 17-year-old daughter after he abandoned the family for a gay lover. After his partner passed away, Charlie turned to compulsive eating to cope with his grief. According to the outlet, The Whale was critically acclaimed when it made its off-Broadway debut in 2012. It got an outstanding Drama Desk Award. And in 2018, this is what we were talking about the other day, Fraser told GQ that Philip Burke, and we mentioned this, former president of the Hollywood Foreign Press Association groped him from behind in 2003. The actor admitted the incident made him retreat. It made him feel more reclusive. Fraser also told the outlet that the Hollywood Foreign Press Association tried to get him to sign an agreement that stated he was joking about the claim. And Burke said that this was a total fabrication. But Brendan did not sign such documents.
I'm just thinking what voice Kyle Dunnigan can do as it pertains to the story. That's all.
How about Bill Maher who cares about Brendan Fraser? Okay.
Were you at the luncheon, Bill?
Oh, the lunch. Oh, is that when he got groped?
Yes.
From behind.
So Brendan Fraser became a reckless because he got groped. Is that the story?
Yeah, it's basically.
Okay, let me open up my folder. Okay, here it is. Who cares? Let me put that in there.
Oh, you don't care? You don't miss Brendan Fraser's work?
That's an excuse for not getting jobs. Okay.
Oh,
but you don't think
I'm
he was
sorry. If someone grabbed my hiney, I still would be able to do real time. Okay.
But you don't think it's traumatic to some actors to be physically assaulted that way?
It sounded like someone touched his hiney for 2 seconds. I'm sorry. That's not a big deal.
Mr. Maher, we did talk on the show the other day that there was possible taint involvement.
Oh, who cares about the taint? Nothing goes on with the taint. It could be on your shoulder. That's just an in-between area.
Okay. Bill, let's do a little role playing.
Oh, great.
You could play a sexual assault grief counselor.
This isn't me being sarcastic, by the way. Oh, great. I can't wait to do this bit.
You're a sexual assault counselor.
Counselor, okay.
Yeah, grief counselor. I'll be Brendan Fraser explaining I was just groped by the...
Come on in, Brendan. Let's hear about your story.
Well, I was attending...
So what happened to you?
I was at a luncheon for the Hollywood Foreign Press.
Okay, bunch of douchebags. Okay.
Yeah, well, as it turns out, I agree with you now because the leader of the Hollywood Foreign Press actually groped me before
we say groped, can you be a little more specific?
Well, he took his right hand, and I can tell he's right-handed because I saw him writing something down. He had the pen in his right hand, so he took his good hand.
You're like Columbo. Okay.
Okay, I'm trying to express. I'm pretty broken up.
Oh, you are.
Yes, I am.
You can't even do a movie for 15 years because of this.
I don't know what the future holds. All I'm saying is I'm pretty upset about this sexual assault.
Okay, he touched your taint, is what I heard.
Oh, you'd heard that?
On the Adam Carolla show, I heard someone touched your taint.
This happened 15 minutes ago. I came right to your office. I can't believe the news beat me here.
Well, it's a good Adam Carolla's on it. Especially that Gina grad. What a piece.
Have you ever had your taint touched, Bill?
Yes. I say move your fingers 2 inches to the north, bitch.
So you're saying you appreciate having your taint touched?
It doesn't do anything.
Mm.
Okay. I'm sorry, I'm talking to Brendan. Mm. So someone touched your taint, so you couldn't do a movie? You became a recluse? Is that what I'm hearing?
I didn't feel safe anymore being outside.
You didn't feel safe.
Yeah.
Okay.
I felt
and none of this has to do with the fact that all your other movies stink.
Hey, speaking of my career, I haven't been on your show since you were doing PI.
Oh yeah, we have famous people on now.
I'm pretty recognizable.
People whose taints get touched and then they continue to wake up in the morning and do work. Those people.
Shots fired.
Oh, geez, Bill. I came here for some solace. I didn't know you're going to.
Oh, time's up. You owe me $100.
And scene. All right. Let me hit solo stove here before we move on to our next story. Whether you're camping in the woods or hanging out in the backyard, nothing like a roaring fire. Oh, especially when it's cold outside and it's getting there now. Solo Stove, fire pits and stoves engineered for adventure. Stainless steel construction designed to regulate airflow and burn more efficiently. So little smoke, you wonder where the fire went. Yeah, so much fire and so little smoke. Yeah, these things are stainless steel. They're top quality. I've been using mine for well over a year now. It is so nice. Good for camping, good for the backyard. No campfire smell on the clothes or hair, nothing left but ultra-fine ash for easy cleanup. Portable and built to last as well. And light and easy to get started with just a few little bits of starter and kindling. It is Solo Stove, right, Dawson?
No one needs a reason to gather around the fire. Solo Stove just took away any reason not to. And now you can get $10 off when you use promo code Adam at checkout. Just go to solostove.com. Remember, you get $10 off when you use promo code Adam.
All right, let's do another one, Gina Grad.
Oh, good, because this one has a little special surprise buried within it. So a manhunt is underway for six inmates who broke out of a California prison by climbing to the 20-foot-high roof, an escape that wasn't discovered until the next day, according to Fox News. This is in Merced County. So the Merced County Sheriff said they used a makeshift rope out of braided sheets and were able to come down the side of the building.
That's how they escaped in Tango and Cash.
That was what I was going to say. Is my favorite Sylvester Stallone movie.
They went up to the roof of the building and they escaped with a zip line.
That's right.
They stole my idea.
Was that your idea, Mr. Stallone?
Of course it was. We were trying to figure out how do we get down from the roof. You know, as we were writing the script. And I said, what if there's like a rope of some kind? These are the kind of ideas that, you know, make a great film.
But don't you think most people would have that idea if you're on the roof and you had to get down?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I could be wrong, but I think everyone was pretty stumped.
But you think they'd be like a giant stork?
Yeah, we talked about a stork.
Oh, you did?
Some sort of giant crane. It was originally in the script.
Explore every idea.
Mm-hmm. But they were like, how does a crane get there? Who's operating became a problem. Anyway, eventually I came up with that idea. So that is nice to hear that people escaped with my idea.
It's probably because they watched the movie. But the thing that's crazy about this is the sheriff went on to say that. So you might wonder, why didn't they discover this until the next morning if this happened at night? Mm-hmm. Well, they do have officers walking up and down cell blocks, but they're no longer allowed to wake prisoners up because they deemed it necessary for them to have a good night's sleep.
So this is daycare.
If you're just walking by and you see something bundled under the bed, that has to be good enough for you. He added that the prison has been facing staffing shortages in recent years due to state and local budget cuts. The inmates are, remember, there's six of them between 19 and 21 years old. Three of them are facing murder charges and two have been accused of firearms offenses. So they're on the loose because we didn't want to disturb their slumber in the middle of the night.
What city are they in?
They're in Merced County.
Oh, Merced County. I feel like we always catch up to those guys, right?
Yeah. Well, this happened the other day, and I've been waiting for news, but no, they're still on the loose as far as Fox is concerned.
Well, Merced County, where's that?
Merced?
Northern?
Well, no, between San Jose and Fresno.
San Jose.
It feels very northern to me.
Sly, you know where San Jose and Fresno is?
Well, those towns. Never heard of those towns before.
Yeah, well, it's up north, like around San Francisco.
That's what Canada is.
Pretty big city.
There's another couple states in between.
Yeah, it's a confusing story, Gina. Sorry to put you down, but that story made no sense.
Are you not familiar with Washington State or Oregon?
Washington State, that's where the president is, of course. I am familiar with the United States and Washington.
Okay, I stand corrected.
You know,
you're probably right.
I realize our batting average is very high on finding escaped prisoners, right? They always find
them. Seems to be.
And
yes.
If I was a warden, I would just announce everyone's first day. I would go, look, we caught you when you had a wallet, a car, and shoes. If you attempt to escape this prison, you will be wearing pajamas with no money and barefoot. You don't think, and you'll be in very close proximity of the prison.
To the prison.
So when we caught you, you were several hundred miles away from here. You had friends. You had a network. You had an automobile. You had a passport, an ID. There are many options you had, and yet we caught you.
And you probably weren't in bright orange.
Good luck in your orange pajamas, barefoot, with no cash and no ID right next to the prison. Good luck.
Not well fed either.
Right. So let's... right. So spare me the charade and let's not go through this again. What are the chances we don't catch you again?
And there's six of them, which I don't, on one hand, I think it makes things easier. But on the other hand, if they all fan out, I don't know how many of them are sticking together.
You think there's arguments about fanning out? Like, you think if someone just went, all right, fan out, and they all went the same direction, there wouldn't be a huge argument? Like, come on, you know I'm a Southwest guy.
So they're Abbott and Costello, or what?
We clearly discussed this on the handball court not a week ago.
We should stick together. Who said that?
All right. There was a funny... I don't know. There was a comedian a million years ago, and I cannot remember who it was, but he had this joke that always kind of made me laugh, where he was like, the notion of a posse, like, get everyone into the center of town, everyone gather up, everyone get in, and then he'd go, all right, now spread out. And it was like, it was this notion of getting everyone together and then telling everyone to run away from each other. Well, hopefully they'll be caught. Because, like, if you're an international jewel thief and you break out, or you're an embezzler, or you're something like that, maybe. But, you know, when it comes to the guns and the murder and that kind of shit, it'd be nice to catch you. All right, let's do one more, Gina Grant.
All right. Well, Eugene, Oregon is taking a new approach to sheltering the homeless by building something that I had never heard of before. Maybe you have, called Conestoga Huts. Have you heard of that?
No.
I'll show you a picture of them. So there are these 60 square foot indoor living spaces. They're weatherproof. They provide a place to store your things. And if it kind of looks like a covered wagon, that is, there's a reason for that.
Oh,
so they look
yeah.
like a Conestoga wagon, which was the precursor to the prairie schooner over wagons that helped the settlers. So it really does look like the top of a covered wagon. The hut's designer says these structures are stronger and more permanent than tents, and they cost about $2,500, whereas a tiny home cost between $10,000 to $20,000. And these little tent, or these homes, these Conestoga homes, take a few hours to put up. Tiny homes take weeks. So this may be the new direction in terms of housing people.
It's sort of like we're getting to the point where it's like everyone is waiting for the Rose Parade that takes place the next morning. Like, everyone is just hitting the streets, hunkering down, waiting it out. But I always wonder, like, on the other hand, you go, well, let's have some good shelter for these people. But aren't there just going to be more people that are living this way? And is it going to turn into a shit show? And my thing is I will give you one of these huts, but I got to see you up in the morning working. Like, here's the deal. If the city's going to pay for this, You gotta pay off your debt. I don't know. Maybe they call it indentured servitude. I don't know. But I mean, I want you up picking up litter in the morning. I want you trimming the ivy by the side of the freeway. I want you water blasting or pressure washing the graffiti. Like, I want an army of people just walking around like catfish and just taking up everything that's on the ground. Like, you can't sit in there and slam drugs. I need you working.
Yeah, and you can lock it, which I think is, you know, is maybe good and bad. But one woman, and look, I don't know if this is the norm. This is the person they found to interview. But she said, you know, I'd like to get a job, you know, at the grocery store. I'd like to just get a job anywhere that's hiring. But when I don't have an address and I'm carrying everything I own with me, who's going to employ me? So if you have a place to store everything, and technically they'll give you an address, now you can start thinking about being a part of society again, as opposed to, like, well, let me show up with I have my own grocery cart for the grocery job.
If this is part of a larger rehabilitation, I'm all for it.
Yeah. Well, hopefully. All right, let's bring it home, Gina Grant.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news. Gina
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Well, last but not least, there is Geico. Do you own? Do you rent? Well, you do one or the other. You want to save a bunch of money? Go with Geico, because you bundle. You take your homeowner's insurance or your renter's insurance, and you put that together with your automotive policy, and then you save at Geico. So go to geico.com, get a quote. See just how much you could be saving when you go to geico.com. That is geico.com. All right. Well, as mentioned, Naples, Florida, off the hook this weekend. Kyle Dunnigan's going to be with us doing stand-up there as well. I want to thank Frank Stallone for zooming in today. Stallone, Frank, that is, the doc, Jason Whitlock. You can check him out at blaze.com, and also shoot him a tweet at Whitlock Jason. Kyle Dunnigan, of course, they got a new YouTube series, At Home with Sly Stallone. You can subscribe at youtube.com/Kyle Dunnigan and shoot him an Instagram or tweet. The Instagram is at Kyle Dunnigan1, and a tweet is Kyle Dunnigan, and the website KyleDunniganComedy.com as well. So thanks, Kyle. Until next time, the Sam Crow for Gina Grad and Paul Bryan saying mahalo.